Father, we call upon you today, and we do declare what a great and mighty God we serve. Oh, Lord, bless your holy name. Bless you in everything today. Oh, may your spirit be poured out upon your people. Thank you for the opportunity that we've had to come into your house and to worship you. Thank you, Lord, for your salvation. Thank you that, Lord, you reach us when we were unreachable, and you change our life, and you save our soul. And God, you write our name in heaven, and you become our God, and you live within us. And Lord, I'm so glad that we have you in our life today. I'm also so glad that you are the great physician, the healer. Not only do you heal our soul, but you can heal our bodies when we're sick. A lot of sick folks right now. People been in the hospital this past week. Percy Gunner had surgery this past week. And Lord, just a lot of things happening in the lives of people. But this same God, who is the same yesterday, today, and forever, he can turn all things around because, Lord, once again we declare, proclaim, Lord, lift up, and Lord, are excited about. The fact is, there's nothing too hard for our God. Now, Lord, people may have come in here today with heavy hearts or going through struggles or trials. People may be having to make decisions in life. Lord, I pray right now the Spirit of the Lord will just come down upon them today and give them a calm and a peace. And whisper into that spirit, that peace be still, because we've got a God who's with us. We've got a God who's for us. And Lord, with you on our side, we can't go wrong. So thank you for that promise today. Thank you for your mighty presence. Thank you for the Holy Spirit. Thank you for the blood that was shed and given at Calvary. Thank you, Lord, that you died in our stead at Calvary. Thank God they put you in a tomb and on the third day you arose again. Thank God that no grave could hold your body down. Thank God death couldn't defeat you. The grave couldn't conceal you. Oh, thank God that you are alive and well today. And Lord, I know you're real. I know you're alive. I know you're almighty. I know you're everlasting. I know you're majestic. I know that you're good. I know that you're God. And Lord, I praise you today. May we as a church today become overly excited about this God whom we serve. May we become overly excited about this God. May we become overly excited about this God whom we serve. And may the Spirit of the Lord absolutely rule and reign in this place today. Be honored and be blessed and be glorified and be exalted. And we praise you today in the blessed name above every name, the sweetest name we know, and that is the name of Jesus. To God be the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's children said, praise God.
Praise God.
And amen. God bless you today. Glad you're here.
There's a woman living next to me, just trying to make ends meet. And she's just one track away from losing it all.
There's a broken man I know, he's barely holding on to hope. He's trying to get back up from his last fall.
My own trials that no one else can see. Without Jesus, tell me, where would I be?
Everybody's going through something.
Everybody faces a storm now and then. So if everybody's going through something, I'd rather go through something with him. Storms come and waters rise, and everybody cries. It's part of living while we're living down here.
But I'm glad I'm not alone on this road my trust in him, so there's nothing to fear.
And when life leans through a curtain,
no one thing is true.
There's a God who will see me through.
Everybody's going through something. Everybody faces a storm.
Without Jesus.
And express how great our God is. Hi, everybody. Glad you're with us here at the Gethsemane Baptist Church. And it is a great day, a beautiful day to praise the Lord, for our God is a great and mighty God. I pray that your heart is touched. I pray today that you're saved and that you know Him as your personal Savior. If not, I pray that He'll deal with your heart, and today you'll come to this saving knowledge of knowing Jesus as your personal Savior. Well, today we're going to be back in the book of Genesis, talking today about the joy of our Creator. Listen, if you can't get Genesis right, you can't get any of it right. Thank God there is a glorious account of our God, just not in creation, but also in the fact of who He is, how majestic and glorious He is, but also the fact that He provides salvation today. Stay tuned for the message. I just believe your heart is going to be touched. Come worship with us here at Gethsemane Baptist Church, 411 Blue Ridge Street, one block off of Lakeside Drive. We're near the main entrance to Lynchburg College. I will look forward to seeing you in the church where the shout has not gone out. May God bless you today as we praise His glorious name. Amen. The Lord of praise in the house of the living God. Come on. Have you been touched by the Lord today? I mean, He'll not only touch you in salvation, He'll touch you in every need of your life. He'll lift you every burden. He'll change things. He'll change your heart, change your life. He'll even change your mind. And today I pray you've been touched by Him. If you got a burden on your heart today, just put it in His hand. He can turn all things around. He's the God who cares. Amen. And He touched me, yes, oh, He touched me, and oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something, oh, wonderful happened, and now, yes, I know He give the Lord a praise. Amen. Thank God. He's a touching God. Amen.
It was early in the morning, and a stillness filled the garden where he lay. Then the ground shook with power as the angels came and rolled the stone away. Then the glory of the living God broke through to the darkness of the tomb. And the love of the Father came and filled every corner of the room.
Love was in the room, and new life was born where only death had been. Was in the room, and death and hell would never reign again. When the glory of the living God broke through to the darkness of the tomb, the earth was filled with his beauty, and love was in.
Trapped in sin and weakness, sinking ever deeper day by day. Then the blessed Holy Spirit came to touch my heart and roll the stone away. Then the glory of the living God broke through to the darkness of the tomb. And the love of the Father came and filled every corner of my room.
You see, his love was in the room, and new life was born where only death had been. Love was in the room, and death and hell would never reign again. Oh no, when the glory of the living God broke through to the darkness of the tomb, the earth was filled with his beauty, and love was in. Of the tomb, the earth was filled with his beauty,
and love was in the room.
Love was in the room. Love was in the room.
I'm actually going to be using the first 13 verses. He said, preacher, this is going to be a long year if you preach on Genesis every Sunday. Well, I'm not planning on that, but whatever the Lord wants. I hadn't planned on preaching on it this long, but he just keeps pouring more on, and hallelujah for the Word of God. But, you know, God really directed me to this because I believe that there's so much more in Genesis than just the first verse. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. There's so much more, and there's so much revealed to us about what the rest of the Bible is about, simply contained in the first few verses of Genesis. It is ultimately, absolutely amazing when you look at this. And this is why God placed me here with this message for you over the last several Sundays on Genesis, is to enlighten you, to encourage you, and to bring you into that full realization of the joy of our Creator. And so from Genesis 1, 1 through 13, we'll be sharing today the thoughts, because several weeks we've been in this book of the beginning called Genesis, and it's an amazing book. And the book of Genesis has basically two major themes or sections, if you would. One is what is called the prologue. You've heard that term, the prologue, but this contains basically four major events that, of course, happened in the book of Genesis that we must believe. You've got to believe. See, a lot of people say, well, I believe the Bible, but no, there's no buts about it. You believe it or you don't believe it. You believe in the creative acts of God and what God said in His Word about what happened, or you don't believe it. I believe everything that happened in God's Word that God said happened, happened. And so therefore, there are basically four major areas in this prologue today. One, of course, is the creation. We've talked about the creative acts and the creative hand of God, and God said, let there be, and there was. We may talk about somewhere down the road, someplace, sometime, about the fall. Adam and Eve sinned, and of course they disobeyed God, and they sinned, and they brought shame and sin and disgust upon every person through time. For the Bible says all have sinned. Then the third area is what we know as the period of the flood. And God told Noah to build an ark. And in that building of the ark is one of the glorious pictures of salvation that you'll ever see. And then fourthly, we find is what is called the Tower of Babel, and where people were trying to build a way to God, but there's only one way to God. And that is even described in the book of Genesis, because not only was God in the beginning, but the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit were there. And so we see in this fact, even in the very first thing that God did, the creation of light, and He said, let there be light, and there was. And what did the light do? It dispelled the darkness, didn't it? And so that light, you look at that light, here is the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the light that dispels every darkness and sin in our life. Then we connect not only this part, but then the second basic area, a section, is not only the prologue, but the next is the basic narrative, so which contains four great individuals, and I'm not going to get into that because I'll be here all day just preaching on them. So the text of Genesis, actually, if you will look carefully at what God's trying to tell us, it's a worship document. The book of Genesis is about, wait a minute, preacher, worship comes in the New Testament. No. Worship starts in the book of Genesis, first chapter and first verse. And it's about the God whom we worship. It's definitive, for it is a God that today that we worship and that we should worship. A lot of people are worshiping a lot of things in life. Some people worship their money. Some people worship their fame. Some people worship their position. Some people worship everything and anything. But I'm going to tell you, there's no greater worship than the worship that we give to God. And He's desiring, and today we should worship Him. So this worship document today that we call the Word of God, we come to a place of celebration because it reveals the majesty, the power, and the wisdom of our God, of just how really great He is today. Listen, He and He alone is God. You may think you rule your home, your life, but you don't. He is still God. He is the ruler. He is the possessor of all glory today. It is all about Him. Amen. And the wonderful thing about it, you need to start making your life about Him. And the more that you make your life about Him, the more real He becomes in your life. He is the Creator. And not only is He the Creator, but He is the Recreator. He's the only one that can create, and He's the only one that can recreate. What do you mean, preacher? Blessed be the name of the Lord. I'm recreated. By the fact is that I came into this world as I was, lost and undone, but God recreated me. And he birthed me into his family and he gave me salvation. And so therefore today, I've been recreated. Now I'm a child of the King. And I'm not ashamed of the salvation that God has placed within my heart and within my life. So power then is manifest in the creative acts that are done by the Word. God spoke and things happen. You know, God's amazing Word has done amazing things. Amen. And if you don't believe, if you're born again today, are you born again today? Well, you are an amazing born into the family of God person. God worked an amazing act of grace and delivered you. You were down and going to hell. Did you know that? I mean, you were lost without any hope. You were basically condemned and doomed. But God stepped on the scene. And as Tom sung about, oh, the love of God was in the room. Oh, it certainly was. And thank God today that he arose victorious over death, hell, and the grave. He won our victory today. And because of God and because of what he has done in that love that is extended to us, he's done an amazing thing in our life. And this is the wonderful thing about it, friend. It doesn't stop with just salvation. That's out of the gate. That's the beginning point. Thank God he is still doing amazing things in your life. And you may be sitting in this room today, in this house of worship, in this sanctuary, and you need something amazing done in your life today. Maybe you're going through some of the darkest valleys you've ever been through. Maybe you're facing some of the greatest trials. Maybe today you don't know the answers. Maybe today you don't even know how you got here today. But I'm going to tell you something. God will do an amazing work in your life. What have I got to do, preacher? You've got to reach out by faith and trust the Lord because he can turn all things around. See, the devil's out to defeat you. The devil's out to destroy you. The devil's out to step in your face and leave you in a position that you are beaten, bloody, and battered and without hope. But I'm glad that one day the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords came by. And I'm glad he has changed the position. It's no longer the devil's foot on our head. It's our foot on his head. Because thank God we've been made more than a conqueror through Christ today. Nay, in all these things, everything that you're going through, whatever you're facing today, God's got a victory for you. Amen. And he's not going to render you today defeated and down and out and depressed and today absolutely destroyed. God's going to lift you up. And God's going to do an amazing thing in your life today. Let's go to the pages of God's Word. And I invite you today to Genesis 1, 1 through 13. Very familiar portions of Scripture. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God. Oh, you ought to underline that. If you're one of those highlighter folks that like to highlight stuff, this is a good place to put it. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, he speaks, let there be light. Guess what happened? And there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. Now, that's where we left off last week. And God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters. And God made the firmament and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament, and it was so. And God called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day. And God said, let the waters under the heaven be gathered together unto one place, and let the dry land appear, and it was so. And God called the dry land earth. You're on it today. And the gathering together of the waters called he seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth. And it was so. And the earth brought forth grass, And here, soon, we're going to be cutting it. If it stays warm like it is now, we're going to be cutting grass and picking tomatoes, amen. But anyway, and the earth brought forth grass, an herb yielding seed after his kind, and the tree yielding fruit whose seed was in itself after his kind, and God saw that it was good. Then verse 13, and the evening and the morning were the third day. Each day that we see the brilliance of a new day of sunrise. I don't know if you saw the sunrise this morning, but what a brilliant sunrise. Amen. And later, the sky will turn a brilliant glow of different colors and hues. And then the sun will start to go down, and once again we'll face the darkness of night. I don't know about you, but I like the brightness of day. Amen. Through the night we wait once again for another sunrise that will bring a new day. By the way, David said, this right now is the day the Lord hath made. And he said, you should rejoice in this day. But preacher, I've got this, that, and the other. I'm facing those. Listen, take those things and put them in God's hands. And today, rejoice in the Lord. And know today that he can turn this day around. You can't, but he can. He can make this a good day. Your day may have not started well. Your weekend may have not started well. Your whole year may not have started well. But I'm telling you, he's the God of turnaround. He's the God of miracles. He's the God of grace. He's the God of a new day. Amen. So Jeremiah said, his mercies are new every day. Oh, great is his faithfulness to us. Friend, listen, each morning light conquers our night. Every day. And it brings to us new evidence today of God's loving kindness and God's faithfulness to us today. You didn't go to bed last night worrying if the sun was going to come up this morning, did you? You trusted God that it would. And if you can trust God that he can make the sun go up and the sun go down, and that God can bring rain and God can bring warmth and God can even bring chilly weather sometimes. And for you, Helen, maybe a couple flakes of snow. You had a few flakes last week. Get over it. Amen. He can do all of that. Listen, if this same God can do all of that, make all of this, don't you think he can solve your life and the problems of your life every day? Don't you think God knows what he's doing? Why don't we run off and we get all worked up and we worry and we get all fretted and we do all the things of life and we go through the trials of life and we fall apart? Listen, that's not God's will for your life. It's God's will that you step out by faith and say, even when I don't understand what's going on, I understand the God who is in what's going on. And that God's going to bring good out of bad. Romans 8:28, by the way, is still in the Bible. That he works all things together for good to them that love him, to them that are called according to his purpose. So realizing this today, the rising sun and the rotating earth, it actually brings us hope today. It reminds us, it refreshes us today of the light and the hope and the life each day that darkness is shattered. Amen. Thank God. You think, well, man, darkness was shattered at the tomb. And when Jesus came out, it was already pre-planned by God about what was going to happen. See, God already knew in the very beginning about the fact that he would form Adam and Eve in his image. He already knew about the fall of man. He already knew about everything that would happen. He already knew about Calvary and that his son was going there. There was no board meeting in heaven trying to figure out, what do we do now? Like we do. We fall apart and we panic. God has never panicked because God knows all things. And God can work in your benefit, in your behalf, in all things today. Let me tell you what, man, that's why I see every time I read the Genesis account of creation about light and light shattering darkness, and thank God the presence of God and that he is to be worshipped, I see the image of what God has done in salvation in my life, hallelujah, that he has shattered the darkness of sin, he has pulled down the chains of defeat, and he has set me free, and if the Son shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. Amen. That's the power of our God. That's what our God will do. So realizing this today, whatever anxiety, hang-ups, and struggles, and worry, and depression, and defeats, and uneasiness, and all that is mastered. Hear me. Everything that's going on in your life, it's mastered today when you gaze upon the God of Genesis today. If he mastered darkness and said, let there be, and there was, and he conquered all things, fat friend, he can conquer all things in your life today. Amen. So the God of the beginning is also the God of a new beginning for your life. Perhaps today God has permitted you to walk through. I know, and we've all been there through those places and times of life, and we've asked and didn't understand why we're going through some of the dark places of our life. But do you realize that maybe God has allowed those places to show you how dark the darkness really is, from the standpoint that you might know the brilliance and the greatness and the love and the compassion of the light and the love of Jesus in your life? Friend, don't look at the darkness, look at the light. Amen. God may have shaken the very foundation today of your faith only to show you today how trustworthy that he is today. And he's got all things under control. Amen. You can trust the Lord. You can trust the Lord in everything today. Creation drives us today to trust the Creator. Just not to say, well, you know, I believe in creation. It goes beyond that. It brings you to a place of complete and absolute surrendered trust in God. And you've got to come to that point. Praise God. You can trust the Lord. Amen. Let me give you five quick points here today. Here in creation, God brings order to our confusion. Maybe you're sitting here today. I'm not going to ask you to show your hand. But maybe you're sitting here today and maybe your life is just in a state of confusion today. In the text of the first 3 days of creation, God takes the formless void that we're told about in God's Word and he brings order to it. See, God's not a God of confusion. God's not there wondering what he's going to do next to do something in your life. God has already got a chart and a compass and a plan for your life today. So God takes the confusion that is formless and that is void, and he fills it with order. He brings order to creation. And listen, when you feel confusion in your life today, it's God's working his perfect plan. You're going to have confusing places in your life. You're going to have places that you don't understand. You're going to have places that you're going to ask God why. You're going to have places today that you're just basically rendered in a position that you don't know what to do. I'll tell you what to do. You look to the God of heaven who created and who recreated and who is able, and he'll turn your situation around. Amen. You've got to put your confidence in this God. So you don't see it, but God doesn't work with maps and GPS systems. Thank God. Because I don't put much confidence in either one of them. I've used maps, and I'll tell you what, I did not arrive at where I was supposed to be. We've even used GPS and didn't get to where we're supposed to be. I don't know what happened up there, but satellite got messed up. Something went awry, you know? I mean, we even here a few years ago, One night, Drew and Tip was with us, and we decided to go up to the Star in Roanoke. Yeah. Well, we said, well, I don't remember how to get there. Nobody else did. So we said, just put it in the GPS. Well, we wound up in somebody's dirt driveway on the other side of the mountain. I'm going to tell you right now, it wasn't the Star in Roanoke, Virginia. So we said, cut the GPS off. Let's just guess where it's at, and we arrived. Amen. I'm glad God doesn't guess. And I'm glad God doesn't have to depend upon the mapping systems that we use. I'm glad he orders the day. Are you hearing me? He today has already set in motion today of what you thought was going to be bad, that he's going to bring good out of it. Now, friend, if you convince yourself today that you're going to be in confusion, stay in confusion, and your life is nothing but confusion, guess what you're going to get? You're going to get confusion. That's not God's plan. That's Satan messing with your mind. And he loves to mess with your mind and try to render you defeated and discouraged and down and out. But I'm glad that God works in His perfect plan for you and I. And so in the confusion, God then brings a calm and a peace to your soul. And God brings a plan to your life. And you reach out by faith and receive the plan that God has for you. Things may not have gone the way that you have planned. And you're looking at a living example. I had my life plotted, planned, when retirement was going to be, how many holes of golf I was going to play every day. And I had everything lined up. I was retiring at 55. Well, that's gone. But anyway, and then God said, I don't have a retirement plan for you. I said, wait, hold the phone, Lord. He said, I got a better plan for you. Amen. And friend, let me tell you, God will bring His plan to you if you're trusting today. Things may not have gone exactly the way that you have desired. But let me tell you, in the confusing places of life today, you will find yourself maybe standing on the cliff saying, why? I don't understand. I don't know what to do. Let me tell you what, God is working a plan to your benefit to show you your need of Jesus today in your life. And if you today by faith will reach out and trust Him, He will bring an abundance of heaven to you, and He'll give you a peace and a calm in this confused, messed up world and all this political garbage that we've got going on and everything else, and we're living on the verge of a terrorist attack and everything else. Man, I'm glad that God has given me a peace that surpasses all understanding. Amen. Oh, I'm not worried about tomorrow because I already know who holds my tomorrow and who's already got today under control. Amen. So I can trust the Lord in all things. Amen. Let me tell you something today. Get this in your spirit. Worry is not a part of God's plan for your life. Defeat is not a part of God's plan for your life. But if you perceive that, entertain that, and you stay there, you're going to get that. But that's not what God has for you today. God has a better plan. And therefore today, God today, as a matter of fact, Daniel said, God has an expected end or future for you. He's got something better than you can ever perceive, think of, or imagine. And that's what the power of our God will do. So don't let confusion today defeat you. Put your hand in the hand to bring today that will bring calm and peace to your life. You know, through the death and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, He brought order to our confusion because we were lost, undone, without God. We had no hope. We were going to hell. Have you realized that? But God, through His Son, brought a plan not to defeat us, but to deliver us. Therefore, I can trust Him in those places and times of my life that make absolutely no sense. Second point, in creation, God brings light to our darkness. In verse 3, I find that God speaks for the very first time, and He says, let there be light. Now, I'm not Charlton Heston, and I don't have that deep, roaring voice, and I'm not sure that God does. You know, we try to, I mean, my voice is not like Jerry Butler. You know, when he speaks, the window panes rattle. Amen. That deep voice resonates and fills the room. Until Bonnie says, shut up, Jerry, be quiet. No, she don't say that. No, that's kidding. She don't say that. No, I'm just picking on. God speaks and says, let there be light. And the light is what we know ultimately. You know, we think, oh, He brought the Son about, He gave light. No, ultimately, He's talking about Jesus here. Have you read 1 John 1, 4 and 5, which goes in concert with Genesis 1. He says, in Him was life, and the life was the light of man. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. So the light in Genesis, the light in John, and the light even in the Revelation is the same light. It's the Lord Jesus Christ. Scientists and universities today and so many other different forms, they try to cause you to doubt God and to doubt His existence and His creative acts. But praise God, who is such as this great God, this giant of a God whom we serve today? There's none like it unto Him, the Word says. That this same God that spoke and created and did is the same God that says, I'm going to have mercy on you. And He had mercy on me because He saw in Genesis that I would need mercy. And he applied the mercy of heaven through the glorious Son of God, the Lord Jesus Christ, who provided the deliverance from the clutches of sin and the control of Satan. And glory to God, through this one, I have been freed from sin and Satan, the world, the flesh, and the devil. I am a child of the King, and the light has touched my life. And let me tell you what, when he lit up my life in darkness, the darkness dispelled. It's gone. It's dissipated. You can't find it anymore. Amen. Because now I become a child of God, walking in the light of his glorious presence. And oh, what a change and a difference he'll make in your life if you'll let Jesus, the Son of God, shine his light in your life. Amen. Praise God. Amazing. This causes me to pray and ask, Lord, let your light shine on me and through me, that my sins can be forgiven and my heart can be made pure. And we need our sins forgiven every day. I didn't say you got to get saved every day. I'm saying he'll cleanse your heart every day. Genesis 1, 1 through 3 causes me to look to the cross, actually. It draws me to the cross of Christ, because at the cross of Jesus, the light of God shines the brightest. Amen. In the darkness of the crucifixion, Jesus became the light of the world. And it's at the cross that my soul, thank God, is vanished of darkness and gloom and depression and defeat. The book of Genesis reminds me today that God brings order to my confusion of life. Amen. And so God brings light to my darkness. Third point, in creation, God brings purpose to our meaninglessness. You know, our life had no meaning until Jesus came and changed our life. God has a meticulous plan. He has a deliberate plan today behind every creative action that he does. So everything has its purpose, and everything has its place. If you don't believe that, read the book of Ecclesiastes. There's a time and a season for everything, right? And so everything God does, it's done with a meaning that God is doing. He just doesn't arbitrarily do things. He does things with things with a meaning today. So there's no mistakes. There's no mess-ups. There's no accidents with God. What you thought you messed up, God can turn it around. God today can bless you today. In the fatalistic slang that we have today within our society, we say, well, it is what it is. Well, I'm not even sure what that is. It is what it is. I mean, we use all this stuff. Everybody uses it, and we don't even know what it means. And we're out there saying, well, it is what it is. Well, what is it? You ever use that with me? I'm going to ask you that. So what is it that you are, what it is, and what it ain't, and what it, I mean, you in confusion. God doesn't bring confusion. He brings a definitive pattern of life for you today. And you've got to trust him. So don't use that term with me, okay? So get, because I don't know what it is and what it, whatever it is. It is what it is. Amen. I know some of y'all look. Some of you wives and look at your husband and you say, yeah, it is what it is. But anyway, but it doesn't mean it is what it is. Can't be changed. Amen. All right, I better get off of that. God can draw form out of the void. That's what he did in Genesis 1, 1 and 2, wasn't it? And God's will was to make perfect sense. You don't have to walk around confused. People worry themselves to death. God only can bring light to your situations that will dispel the darkness and the confusion. The only perfect sense of God shines on us through his Son, Jesus. Amen. So that place where God speaks into your heart and he says, let there be light. Amen. So some of you are living in darkness today. Maybe some of you are struggling. Some of you today have some dark places in your heart. Some of you today have some sin issues going on. Some of you may have issues that you've been doubting God in what He is doing in your life. Some of you today have unfaithfulness issues in your life. Some of you today stand in need, and the light of Christ is going to bring today a meaning to your life. But you've got to cooperate with what God's plan is for your life. Amen. So every dark heart needs to be illuminated by Christ Jesus today. And He will. If you're sitting here and you're lost, let me tell you, you need salvation. You need to be saved. So when God speaks light, you know what He speaks of? Every time you see God speaking about light, you always attach that He's speaking Jesus. Because He's the only one that can bring true light to your life. So our lives were in darkness until God spoke into our heart and said, "Let there be light." And that light came in the person of Jesus Christ, and He refreshed and changed your heart and your life. Do you need the light today? I'm glad it's still available for whosoever will come to Him. Amen. And then fourthly, in creation, God blesses what He makes. If you'll notice, there's a pattern in creation. The song of creation has what we call a refrain. And when you read the creative account, we are reminded today, this is how our God works. So this is found in verse 4, verses 10 through 12, or 10 and 12. So in each of these verses, God saw that it was good, meaning when He says it was good, He was saying it's correct. God did not make any mistakes, blunders. God was pleased with His work, and there was nothing more to add to what God has done. I'll tell you something. I'm glad He does a complete work in us. Maybe you're not all you could, should, and ought to be. But glory to God, you're not what you used to be. Amen. And let me tell you what. He has put salvation in you. And friend, He has redeemed you and made you a child of the King today. And He has made a complete work in you. You may not see all the results yet, but let me tell you what, you will. And God will work through your life. Those struggles, those paths of pain that you go through, those difficult places that you have to encounter, God's working His perfect plan and shining the light to refine you, to strengthen you, to build you up, and to make you the person that God wants you to be. He's working completeness in your life. He didn't just save you and say, "Okay, go now. Good luck. Hope you do all right. Oh, if you need anything, just call me." I've heard that story before. It always interests me when you go in these hospitals and these doctors and they do surgery on you. Now, if there's any problem, you just call me. Yeah, just call me. Yeah, I mean, like he's been put in Fort Knox and you can't even get to him. Amen. I mean, those receptionists and those people in the front offices, they stand there with bayonets between their teeth and M6. No, anyway. But, oh, watch it, Debbie. Amen. But you never can get them. I never understood that. But anyway, God does a complete work. If you don't believe that, read Philippians 1:6. Being confident in this very thing, that He which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. So God creates, God looks, and what does God see? Hey, listen. What does God see when He sees you? Amen. He recreates and He works in our life. Praise God. He has come and made a difference. And let me wrap up today. One more point and I'm through. Because of Christ, you know, God can look on you today, isn't this awesome, and say, it is good. Amen. But the fifth point, in creation, God enables His work. God makes it so when He made what He has made, so it can function. So we function. How do we function, Pastor? We function in the Word and through the Spirit of the living God. You can't function by any other means. From the very beginning, I'm going to tell you, it's been the Word. As I pointed out to you, John 1, Genesis 1, they are dovetailed together. They go together, Old Testament, New Testament. John 1:1 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." So the very spoken Word of God, guess what it did? I mean, God didn't sit up there with a box full of Play-Doh and try to make an earth. God just spoke it, breathed it, and it became. And let me tell you, the very spoken word of God, God said, let there be, and there was. And the Bible shows us that God's holiness, He shows us our sinfulness, and He shows us our need of a Savior. And it's important today that you and I have a strong, biblical-based foundation today in the Word of God. If you are omitting the Word of God in your life, you're missing the point. Amen. I tell people every day, read the Word of God. Get through what you're going through with the Word of God. Amen. And so it's important that you have this and that you build your life on the Bible. Build your home on the Bible. If you're omitting the Bible, it's not going to work. So also today, you find the Word, but in Genesis 1 and 2, you find the Spirit of God. Remember, I pointed that out to you. God's Word brings order. God's Spirit brings life. God's Word brings order. God's Spirit brings life. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost or the Spirit of God moves on you. You now have the power of God working in your life. You couple that with this, and you couple that with the Spirit of God, and that works in your life. Look out, devil. You're armed and dangerous. You now have become a powerhouse for God. And today, now you can be that witness that God wants you to be. We today, we need a moving. Come on, church. We need a moving today in this sanctuary of the Spirit of God. We need a moving in this church. We need a moving within the confines. You know, we're looking at in our nation, we're looking at all the economic and the moral and the terrorists and all these components, and we're seeing the president going through the issues that he is facing and our entire government. It's just not him. It's all of us. But I'm going to tell you, it's not government that's going to change this nation. It's going to be the Spirit of God working in born-again, blood-washed Christians. And we need an old-fashioned moving of the Holy Ghost in churches today. We don't need hype. We need holiness. We don't need something that lasts a second, then it's gone. We need something, man, it comes in and it stays. It stirs you up. Bless God, it fires you up. I mean, you're excited about this God whom we serve. See, this is a God that wants to work this plan that to remove you from the darkness. And don't focus on everything that's happening in this world. Focus on the God who is still in control of this world. Amen. God doesn't make any mistakes. You say, but what are we going to do? We're going to keep doing what we've always done. We're going to trust God and put our faith and our confidence in Him. And when we get to that position and that place today, I'm going to tell you, we need that moving. Come on, church. We really need that moving of the Spirit of God. You need it in your home. You need it in your life. You need it in every part of your living. And so therefore, moving sinners into the place of salvation, moving today backsliders back to God. Amen. I texted a fellow yesterday, and I really put some heavy language on him about he need to be in church, need to get his life straightened out. Need to get away from the attractions of the world. Need to get back where God wanted him to be. Well, amazingly, he didn't answer my text. And he didn't show. But you think I'm going to give up on him? Because I know what God can do. And let me tell you what. He today can bring the backslidden back to a right relationship, but it's going to take a moving of the Spirit of God, moving the burden from deliverance, moving the trouble to the peace of God that surpasses all understanding, moving our worship back to the place that we praise this great, marvelous, and mighty God. Moving. Oh, you hear me, church? We're moving today. We need the moving of God. Amen. We need the moving of God in our life. We need the moving of God within today. Every one of you, here's an altar today, and God wants to move you today. You can stay like you are, or you can move to this altar. Call on the righteous God of creation. and be moved by the Spirit of God and claim the power of the Word of God. Amen. Hallelujah. I invite you, this is it. Come and experience the joy of the Creator. And friend, and let Him move on you right now. Let's stand. Let Him move on you right now. Let Him move on you right now. You don't have to wait until Joe fires up music to get you to an altar. There should be already a moving to the altars of God. A calling and desiring and saying, Lord, I come and I want you to move in my life. I ain't come with my plans. I've come for your plans. Oh, Father, right now in the mighty name of Jesus, touch hearts and lives. Draw us today. Lord, touch hearts, touch lives, touch people. Draw us to this place that you have us to be. And move mightily upon us today as only you can. Have your way, Lord. You come. You come.